It's gonna be a football game tonight, man.
No doubt.
It's gonna be a football game
here. Okay.
I done been here.
All right, let's go, baby.
The nine. Rushing four, ball comes out of the hands of Newton. It's on the ground and still on the ground. Picked up by T.J. Ward at the four-yard line. Vaughn Miller did it again.
Alabama back on top of the college football world.
Ladies and gentlemen, football to the max.
Your host, Sean Garmer, Gary Vaughn, and Randy Isbell.
The following podcast is a W2M Network original production. Visit W2Mnet.com for all of our other great podcasts, plus news, reviews, articles, and opinions from the worlds of wrestling, video games, football, and entertainment.
Hello and welcome to another Football to the Max, the college edition for week five of the season. It's just nice to be back in normal situation, not having to sit outside or not having to be stuck in a car or somewhere else, using a computer I'm not familiar with. And then Randy doesn't have to produce the shows, which I'm sure he's joyous about.
Far less stress just sitting here.
Yeah. I can understand that for sure. It's definitely a busy task producing and hosting and all that stuff. So Sean, I gotta give you credit, man. It's difficult.
It's not something you ever really totally get used to. I still struggle with it sometimes, doing the video game show or whatever. But it is what it is. That being said, there was plenty to discuss from this week in college football. Big four, ranked matchups with the ranked teams against each other. And then you got a lot of upsets towards the bottom half of the poll where you're going, well, who the heck do we put in the poll now? So even in our poll, we had some cool debutantes that we'll give you a little sneak preview of a couple of them, who made it into our poll. But we're not going to give you all of it. You need to make sure you go to, and it's actually up there right now. Make sure you go to WTMnet.com, and you can see right there on the top of the page our top 25 poll, and you can read who's all in it. And, and some of it's somewhere it's other polls and some it's not. So that's what's always fun about checking these things out. Guys, we should probably start with the big game of the weekend, the one everybody was talking about in the ACC, Clemson and Louisville. It looked like it was going to be a blowout going Clemson's way in the first half. The second half, Louisville storms all the way back to take the lead. They even have the lead with it because a two-point conversion fails. And then Clemson gets a touchdown, and Louisville has a really awkward 4th-and-12, and the receiver just decides, well, I'm going out of bounds. And, man, that really felt like Louisville could have really – they had a great chance at winning that game.
Yeah, they did. It was exciting. You know, what was amazing was Clemson got in here early and started frustrating this Louisville offense. I mean, completely. They did not know what to do. They were a little aggravated. They felt like the Clemson defense was kind of taking advantage of them at times. And, fair point. At times, you could kind of see some blatant calls that should have been called that were not called. But at the end of the day, I mean, it all boiled down to – it was up to Louisville to come back and do their thing, and they did. They for sure came back with a vengeance, and made their presence known. But, you know, I got to give a credit to the Clemson defense and the fact that they found a way to step up and to slow Louisville down. And, you know, of course, you know, you got to, you know, Watson just continue to stay patient through this entire game, and they were the victors.
Yeah, absolutely. This is, I don't know if you could ask for anything more from this game. You saw a complete shootout between the two. Watson and Jackson just kept trading punches. You know, Watson, 5 touchdown passes. Lamar Jackson, you know, gets 3 combined touchdowns himself to add to his ridiculous total. And it just went completely back and forth. And yes, we can all make fun of a wide receiver who decided to spin to the outside instead of the inside to try to get there. But, you know, his instinct said to try to make it there, and it didn't quite work, and he fell a yard short. Yes, if he cuts inside, he probably has a better shot, but you know, I'm not going to rag on a kid for a split-second decision like that. This is just a game between two powerhouses that proved that both deserve to be in the playoffs, and we're basically now in a situation with Clemson winning at home that, you know, depending on kind of how some of these other conferences go, that Louisville-Houston game is still a possible playoff matchup as far as sneaking in ahead of a two or three lost conference champion that wouldn't be deserving of a top four. So there could be two teams from the ACC, really, that could make this playoffs.
Yeah, it's very true. And, I mean, if Houston can get by Navy this week, they have a nice schedule until they hit Louisville. So, you know, it's going to be interesting to see how that pans out. Louisville obviously has a little bit of a tougher schedule, but not that much, as they already beat Florida State. They avoid the two big coastal teams. So just kind of have to get through, keep doing what they do, and not let this win affect the, or this loss affect them too much, and get back to what they were doing before this, and that's winning games. Another team that just keeps winning, and even though it seems like they had their toughest test with Wisconsin coming in there, Michigan, it took a ridiculous interception to do it, but they got it done. 14-7, Michigan wins, and they keep their spot.
Hey, listen, before I go into the negative part of this, I will say that interception was one of the best catches I've seen all year, if not this decade. But to say that it needed that interception is incorrect. It was a fourth down play that was not going to be caught. It was behind the receiver. It was one of those, seeing it play out and everyone freak out, and, oh my God, I can't believe they steal the game on a crazy play. Like, it's an amazing play, but an incompletion actually probably would have benefited Michigan more. But still, a phenomenal play and a phenomenal game. This was the exact opposite of Louisville-Clemson. This was two defenses just pounding it out. It just took that one big play from Michigan, the 46-yard touchdown pass that they had late in this game that sealed the deal. But that's what is so great about defensive matchups. It just takes that one play. One play could change the whole thing. Louisville and Clemson, you give up a big touchdown, you know that the other team is going to come back and probably answer. In a game like this, you never know when that one play is going to be that's going to seal the deal. And Michigan just happened to be the team that made that big play.
Definitely. And, you know, this may not have been exciting when it came to the scoreboard, but, you know, still a defensive matchup that kind of left you on the edge of your seat, because you knew anything that happened, whether it be a turnover or, you know, giving up a big play, could be the deciding factor in the game. And that's exactly what happened here. No big surprise. But, I mean, I'll say this, still impressed with Wisconsin. Michigan, you know, high in the rankings, you kind of expect them to be, you know, the guys that take the game. But honestly, Wisconsin was in this the entire time, and they're deserving of still being up there and people recognizing how great their team is.
Yeah, they do. You know, this was a game that I think people expected Michigan's going to win coming in. This is one of the better defenses they're going to play all year. So the offensive not being able to score a lot of points against them, maybe that's a little bit alarming when you get into perhaps, you know, especially that Ohio State game, which, you know, yeah, Ohio State really hasn't played a whole lot of anybody either. But, you know, it does leave that question mark. Would they be able to keep up with an Ohio State when you get to that kind of game? So that's going to be interesting when we get to that part. But, I mean, it's the Big Ten, and Michigan got their first taste, and they were able to survive. Let's see what they do with the rest of their schedule until you get to that point. And speaking of another conference that keeps getting crazier and crazier every week, Tennessee literally Hail Mary at the last possible second to win the game where it looked like Georgia had it all but sealed. They do the wrong kind of kick. The returner takes all the way to like the 45 of Georgia, and then they decide they're just going to Hail Mary it. And clearly there's a guy standing in the back of the end zone, and he just doesn't pay enough attention and waits too long to start jumping, and he gets outclassed by the other receiver, and Tennessee wins. Just these guys just keep doing this, and they keep winning.
You know, it's amazing. It really is. I mean, several times this season so far, you could say Tennessee may not have deserved to win that. I mean, it was at the very end is the way they find a way to get it. And once again, here they are. You know, it's going to catch up. And I know I'm maybe giving away something for our next show, but I think eventually it will catch up. I don't see this team being able to play these close games. It caught up with Georgia, and I feel like it's going to happen the same here. But this team, they wrap and they do whatever they can to win, and impressive, but it's just it's too close.
I did think that that Georgia was the better team here. Sean, you pointed out some of the mistakes they had at the end. They also had that awful fumble in the end zone when their quarterback decided that pump faking twice while standing in the middle of his end zone was a wonderful decision, as he was then sacked and gave up the ball for an easy touchdown for Tennessee. But listen, Tennessee never gives up no matter what, even after giving that big play up that looked like they lost the game with 20 seconds to go. They kept fighting, they kept trying. And then, you know, at the end, they're still undefeated. I still don't know how they're doing it, but you have to give them full credit.
Yeah, you definitely do. Until they have that loss, you really can't hate on them for what they're doing. You're supposed to just win. They're winning. Sometimes it isn't about making sure everything looks pretty and whooping everybody by 30 or 40 points. Sometimes you just got to go in there and get a win. And that's what Tennessee did. And like you said, they didn't give up, and they got it. So, you know, now you move on to even tougher competition for Tennessee. Like Gary said, who knows how much longer this is going to last, but for now, they stay undefeated and 2-0 in that SEC. Another team that suffers another loss, and they still have a big matchup coming, too. A couple of big matchups coming, honestly, even next week. Florida State falls to North Carolina by a field goal at the last second, after DeAndre Francois had actually scored with 23 seconds left. And North Carolina just decides, okay, we're going to go up here, we're going to kick this field goal. 54-yard field goal, by the way. That's not a chip shot in college by any means. And don't blame the kicker for going nuts with the tomahawk chuck afterwards, because I would too. And, yeah. North Carolina, give me a little preview of they get themselves into our top 25 as they did to everybody else's pretty much, and yeah, with this big win.
Yeah, this was the game that I decided to watch from start to finish during that early slate of games over the Michigan-Wisconsin game. And, you know, the first half was interesting with North Carolina jumping out 21-7 and everyone trying to figure out what was going on with Florida State. You know, they're usually a second half team anyways. And then the second half just completely blew up, where every drive but two ended in a touchdown. Well, other than the game winning field goal right at the end, and just two teams going back and forth. The play that Francois made to take the lead there for Florida State, where he just like Olayed defender and ducked underneath him. Just completely impressed with what they did. You could definitely tell that they have some great talent in the running game there. And, you know, yes, their hopes most likely to get into the playoffs are now dashed with two losses, with even more difficult competition coming out. But listen, I am completely impressed with the ACC this year. I think they could be the best conference in college football right now.
They've certainly been tremendous, Gary. I mean, in North Carolina, Mitch Trubisky, this dude is no joke. 400 yards. I mean, I don't know if Florida State's defense is letting everybody get yards on them at this point, but
Definitely. You know, and you got to give credit to North Carolina, and they did a really good job and finding a way to stick around. And once again, North Carolina comes up big, and I wasn't expecting it, to be honest with you. I wasn't sure that they were.
Yeah, I mean, and they haven't even played Miami yet, but North Carolina's got their own tough schedule to go, too. They've got Virginia Tech, which is we didn't put them in our poll just to give you a person you shouldn't be expecting to see, because honestly, they haven't played anybody. And, you know, this first week that they've got here against North Carolina is going to be a true test for both teams. And then they've got Miami in the what could be the Coastal Decider the next week. So, man, you know, you talked about the ACC being great. It's going to keep on being great because all these games, these next few weeks, should be pretty awesome. You know, Miami's got Florida State next week. So that's always a wild game. It always comes down to like a last second field goal or something crazy. So, you know, this conference should continue to be what it is. And that being said, Miami did basically take care of Georgia Tech. That score looks closer than it really was. So, you know, that Miami stays undefeated. Alabama stays undefeated, whooping Kentucky. Ohio State whooped Rutgers. Arkansas whooped nobody. And Washington on that Friday came in there at home and absolutely took Christian McCaffrey out of the game and took Stanford out of the game, 44-6. My God.
Ooh, it was ugly. And, you know, Stanford, I mean, man, they were in a disarray. They really were. Washington, wow. I mean, just proved it. They're for real.
Yeah, absolutely. Christian McCaffrey completely struggled in this game, and nobody else could get anything going. This was nearly a shutout. Washington won both sides of the ball completely. Jake Browning looked great. Gaskin was amazing as a runner. So just straight up complete domination by the Huskies. And, you know, they're really the only hope for the Pac-12. Everyone else in that league is kind of been proven to be mediocre. They keep losing to each other, and it's only going to continue. So if they want to have a team in that four-team playoff, it has to be Washington.
Yeah, you're right about that, because Oregon just keeps sucking. And another team that could have had a shot if they knew how to actually get in the end zone, Utah. How do you have four downs to get in the end zone at the last, basically under 30 seconds, and you cannot figure out how to get in? Just amazing. But California winds up winning and beating Utah at home, giving Utah a loss that they probably shouldn't have had.
They actually had seven plays once they got inside the 10-yard line and just could not get it done. Complete disappointment for Utah. You know, always playing in a road game against a conference opponent is tough. California's offense is no joke, but they had it right there in their hands to win it and just came up short.
Yeah, and, you know, it's not like the California's defense is, you know, one of the top rated or anything, but you got to give them credit. They stepped up in big games, and this is a big for them. And, you know, to hold Utah in check and not allow them to get there in the 1 yard line, you know, that's a difficult task. You got to give them credit. But, man, I'm with you, Sean. You know, you're supposed to be a really good team. Why aren't you getting in the end zone?
Yeah, and I thought their strength is sort of passing. And they decided to just try to keep running and make it obvious what you're doing here. But, you know, it is what it is. Sometimes when you're California, people underestimate your defense. And they thought maybe they could just waltz it in there. And California proved them to them that not happening on this day, certainly. San Diego State getting upset again for the second year in a row by South Alabama. It wound up being a little bit not as close as it was at one point. But, yeah, due to an untimely turnover and everything that I think South Alabama ran back, I was watching the end of this game. Just surprising, right when San Diego State starts making it into polls and people think, okay, maybe they might be somebody you got to watch or they lose.
Yeah, you know, and it's a big surprise for me. I felt like that they were going to, you know, be able to come in here and win, especially for the fact that they've done really well so far this year. But, you know, it is a disappointment for sure because this team has proven that they deserve to be in the rankings, and then now, not so much.
Yeah, they were just starting to sneak into rankings. I know we had jumped them in there, and this is kind of why you always have to wait a few extra weeks before you put a team like this into your top 25, because at any point they can lose, and you'll never see them again.
Talk about a team that I don't know that we planned on. Possibly you need to worry about being an upset alert, but Baylor, my God, they had a problem with Iowa State. They got punched in the mouth, and Iowa State kept scoring on them until they hit the fourth quarter, and they hit a wall that was Baylor's defense, and then Baylor's able to come back. Shock Linwood, 237 yards, just... It feels like somebody figured out that Baylor actually has good running backs.
Yeah, hey, this was a big, you know, surprise to me. I didn't feel like that Baylor was going to be put in this situation. But it was like, you know, that defense had to get some coffee in their system or, you know, I don't know what it was. But they finally woke up a little bit. But still, I mean, to me, this still shows that Baylor does have some gumption, that they are not the team. You know, me personally, I was not on board with this team at all. I kind of felt like that they were maybe a shell of themselves. But I, even after a win like this, where it wasn't like an impressive win because they did get scored on so many points, but I still feel like Baylor's still a solid team. I think there's going to be, you know, weeks like this, and I'm still impressed with them despite the fact that they did, you know, have that pretty high scoring situation.
Listen, I'm actually worried about Baylor. Both of their conference games have been squeakers, and yes, they're still 5-0, and that's all that matters. But you know, the Big 12 has not looked that impressive, and I do think that these kind of scares are going to turn into losses soon. I mean, they still have to go to Texas, they still have to go to Oklahoma, to West Virginia. It's a tough schedule coming up, and they haven't impressed me enough as far as them becoming a possible playoff contender. So this is one of those conferences that I think Louisville and Houston are looking at as possible conferences that will slip out of the playoffs and allow them to get in.
Yeah, you're very true. I mean, you're right about that, because honestly, there's only two undefeated teams left. West Virginia won again. So, and with Baylor having a big schedule like that and Oklahoma winning, they beat TCU in a game that really wasn't this close. They just let TCU get back into it at the end and almost cost them again. That's the problem. You can't lay off when it comes to the fourth quarter, especially in the Big 12 when all these teams are able to put up points. But, you know, you're going to have an Oklahoma team that's going to be angry, especially whoever loses. You know, Texas is basically fighting for Charlie Strong's job at this point. And they got the Red River Shootout this week, and then, you know, whenever you play Baylor, you got two teams right there that are going to be hungry to get wins, and it's going to be really hard for Baylor to try to stay undefeated. Yeah, they got the offense to be able to compete, obviously, but will the defense, you know, not have the cup of coffee that Gary was saying at the wrong time, and that costs you? You know, that's something to keep track of, obviously, going forward for Baylor when they get into all these scary matchups. Speaking of another sort of a matchup that wound up on the other end, Michigan State loses to Indiana in overtime, and I think they're pretty much done here as far as playoff goes. Maybe, you know, something for the – I don't know. You're done also for your division because you're in the harder division with Ohio State and Michigan. But Indiana, anything to take from this? You know, 3-1.
You know, I look at this as being a game that kind of seals the fate, like you said, Sean, for Michigan State. And I am concerned for them. They'll be in the bowl somewhere down the line, but I think they're pretty much, you know, put a nail on them. I don't know. Indiana is kind of surprising. I really didn't think they'd be there and to do this to Michigan State.
Yeah, Indiana's definitely showing that they're a decent team, but we'll see what they do against Ohio State next week. As far as Michigan State, you're right. Already 0-2 in the conference. Not only should they never think about the playoffs again this year, no chance of winning the Big Ten even, and probably a mid-tier bowl in their future.
Yeah, they're playing the Church's Chicken Bowl. So.
You never know. That might be a bowl at some point.
I'm sure that they have like 1,000 of them. So,
assuming it's staying in the Big Ten, do you think, you know, Nebraska, at one point it looked a little bit dicey, but they were able to just blow it open in the fourth quarter and beat Illinois, who obviously, you know, one of the worst teams in the Big Ten. But they do have some interesting games. They do have to play Ohio State. They have to play a few others. What are y'all feeling on Nebraska?
I look at Nebraska as a fairly decent team. I think they've got a lot of talent, but I don't know if I'm ready to put them in the upper echelon. You know, right now they're about right where they need to be. But I do have my fears when they do play those better, bigger teams. I think that, you know, they've held their own against some of these smaller schools, but I'm not sure that the future looks so bright.
Nebraska is one of those teams that's really interesting as far as college goes. I think they're a better team than most people give them credit for, but they're not a sexy team. I mean, yes, the score was close with Illinois, but I don't think they were ever in doubt of losing that game. They like to play the games close. You know, they're not going to blow teams out for the most part, but they find ways to win, and they're one of those teams that are going to give some of these other playoff contenders trouble down the line.
I mean, another team that kind of did this, they kept the game close, but they're able to win Texas A&M. They continue to be undefeated, and then they're 3-0 in the SEC as well. They got a big date with Tennessee next week. That is certainly going to test the mettle of both the teams. Are you feeling like Texas – I mean, it is at home too. I mean, are you feeling – Texas A&M is sort of a for real now?
I don't know if I want to say for real. You know, this is definitely going to be that big test, like you said. I do like, you know, their offense. I like the way that they're moving the ball. But, you know, once again, you've got to see what they can do against some of these bigger teams. And I personally think that Arkansas is better than people give them credit for. A very talented team, and Texas A&M was able to take them down. So I feel like, you know, the Texas A&M is going to give people fits. I really do. Now, you know, I can't tell you that I'm going to predict them to go real far, you know, in the playoff hunt, but I do think they'll still be lingering around for a little while.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously they're in a very tough conference and have a tough schedule, but I think you have to at least say that they're going to be in every game this year. I don't think they're going to get blown out by any of these teams.
Trevor and I didn't look good in this game either, so that's something to keep an eye on. Not that, you know, Josh Dobbs has looked fantastic or anything either, so maybe a game that we think could be a shootout but winds up being a lot closer, more defensive. So that'll be interesting. Ole Miss took care of business, as you would expect with them finally getting a break from the big teams and getting to play Memphis, Boise State. Probably should have scored more, but they took care of business as well to kind of keep their spot. Florida, again, missing Del Rio, only puts up 13 points against Vanderbilt. You got to be worried here about Florida being able to do. Obviously, I mean, as long as Tennessee stays undefeated, it's going to be an issue because they lost to them. But, you know, they still got to play some big teams going forward.
Yeah, yeah. But you take out that Tennessee game, this is how Florida's going to win games, is a very defensive battle. Yes, they're not going to win the division, as Tennessee basically has that thing on lock. But this is a very good team, and you know, this is how the SEC used to be won, was just sloppy defensive battles.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the way that, you know, Florida has to hang around and win games. And, you know, I don't know that, you know, they're going to be anything game busters, but I still think that they're a really talented team and they will hang around.
And you're a Texas Longhorns, Gary, going to Oklahoma State, and I don't know what this was, but it certainly wasn't them playing defense at all. They got absolutely 3 blocked extra points. I mean, come on now.
Yeah, and one return for, you know, some points for the Oklahoma State. So, yeah, you know, I'm not really sure, to be honest with you, what is going on. Defensively, you know, still got a lot of young players, and, you know, I think that's maybe a big place where they need to still work on recruiting. I think, you know, with this week, you're hearing that Charlie Strong is going to be taking over the defense. It's proof that, you know, that the athletic director is not happy with what's going on. Texas fans, of course, alumni are not thrilled, and Charlie Strong is going to try and save his job by taking over that position. But, you know, they've got to figure out something. And if Texas continues to play this way, they're going to be definitely helping out the rest of this Big 12 to look good.
And who would have thought that getting the big win against Notre Dame would then cost Charlie Strong his job, basically, because none of us really thought Texas was quite there yet. We thought they were going to be improved, and then they go out and they beat Notre Dame, and all of a sudden everyone's thinking, oh, they're back, they're a top 10 team. Well, come to find out, Notre Dame is just not very good, and Texas is proving that they still have some work to do, as they've shown the last 2 weeks, especially on defense. And unfortunately, everyone's going, well, you beat Notre Dame, so you should do something, but now you're not, so we're going to fire all of you.
Yep, and watch them win next week. Yeah. And then we're going all over this again. So, I mean, that's the thing with Texas. Sometimes when you think that they shouldn't beat Oklahoma, they do. You know, so
yeah.
It's weird.
It's a very big rivalry, and no matter if you are number one or number two in the country, the other is going to beat you, even if they're terrible. So it's the way it works.
Yeah, it's something Washington has to be careful of, because and their coach is not even joking around. He's not letting any of the players be available to the media ahead of their game against Oregon. So, you know, that's going to be interesting. Houston also took care of business. Greg Ward, 5 touchdowns in that game against Connecticut on Thursday. So, you know, they keep rolling on. And, I mean, we kind of covered all the top 25 at Colorado, Western Michigan Air Force beat Navy, which is a big thing for them. They usually don't. So a lot of these kind of fringe teams kept winning, that made it a little bit harder for us to have to decide towards the bottom what to do with those. Iowa lost again, so they're probably done as far as the Big Ten goes, as long as Wisconsin doesn't, you know, lose anymore. Anybody that you want to – I kind of gave a few away. Anybody that you want to talk about that kind of made it in our poll that you go, man, I'm not sure about that one, or I'm happy that they're in?
Go ahead, Randy. I'll let you go first on this one.
Actually, I have more of the opposite as far as teams that didn't quite make in. It worked better for me because I didn't have a lot of work to do, but I think that, you know, there's a bit of East Coast bias in our poll as UCLA and Colorado both miss out. I think that, you know, they're two very impressive teams, and like I said, the Pac-12 is just going to beat up on each other. UCLA continues to improve after that tough loss against Texas A&M, and Colorado is starting to prove that they're no joke at all, but not quite getting the love of everyone else on our panel.
Yeah, and that's my big issue is Colorado, and it just amazes me. I don't know why Air Force will be in there above them. I think they proved that they definitely deserve it. And Utah is a team that I don't mind hanging around here at the moment, but still concerns me. I don't know. It just irks me.
Really close.
Oklahoma State thing. I'm never gonna get over that, guys.
I think if Oklahoma State had that game,
I'm not saying take them out.
You know, if Oklahoma State hadn't had that game that they shouldn't have lost, I think people would not even be bothering voting them at all. I think it's that always just kind of hangs around, and then when they put up points the way they do, it's kind of hard to. And they did beat a ranked team in Texas. Yes, it's a Big 12, and everybody puts up points, but I think people sort of expected Texas to do more in that game, and they, you know.
I just, you know, I look at this and I say, you know, Oklahoma. I personally feel like, and you know, Oklahoma State will probably beat Oklahoma, but at the end of the day, I just think that all these Big 12 teams are going to beat up on each other, and we're going to have a lot different bottom of the rankings with no Big 12 teams in here. So
probably not. I mean, it's going to be interesting. This whole next week is going to be fun to watch with all these big games going on. We're going to have a lot to pick from and big predictions to make when it comes to, you know, the Friday morning slate. I mean, geez. So many big games between ranked teams, and then not only that, just some fringe games that could be really interesting too. You know, talking about Colorado, they play USC, who looked dynamite in their game last week too. So, you know, again, we could be talking about a whole different situation with rankings when we get into next week. So, this should be really fun. And, I mean, every Saturday it's seeming to be a crapshoot. This parody that we've been seeing a lot more of this year has been really making it interesting. Anything that you guys want to say before we get out of here until Friday for college?
Nah, I got nothing.
I'm just excited about, you know, the weekend coming up, and we'll, you know, get into predictions this next, next episode.
All right, so that'll do it for us again. W2Mnet.com is where you want to go for that top 25 poll that we kind of gave you a little bit of preview of. And, of course, you know, you want to be right here again on Friday morning for the Week 6 preview, where we'll give predictions on all the big games. Of course, especially the top 25, if not a few more in that circle, and I will tell the guys which games this time, so we're not just poking around, and they're having blank stares on their faces like, why the hell are we talking about this game again? So, because that's always, I forget that I do that, and then they're like, you're putting us in a terrible spot, you suck. So, anyway, we move on and we go on. And, of course, you know, if you're an NFL fan, we also do NFL reviews for the week. So we'll have our week four, I'm getting these numbers confused between college and NFL. Week four review with a very interesting Monday night game that just happened, and the Sunday night blowout. That was ridiculous. Then we'll get to talk about, of course, on all the other games as well. And, yeah, so, and, of course, WTM Networks, where you want to go to subscribe to listen to all of our shows, according, and of course, Randy's Fantasy Football to the Max show. You want to listen to that for all your fantasy needs. And, you know, the wrestling show keeps going on, doing a TNA and ROH pay-per-view review as well. So, and, of course, with all the other shows that are on the network that don't involve us as well. So, until then, everybody, later.